This is the primary pinion, the part that the motor turns and the clutch slides on. Clutches don't like oil. Luckily, I think it's just hydraulic fluid from the broken clutch slave cylinder. We'll be replacing that anyway. If it was oil from the back of the engine, that would be annoying, but I think we're safe. This lump in the middle, proudly displaying the best of British symbol, is the main gearbox. This piece on top houses the gear selector shafts. The spring contraption is Land Rover's complex method of making reverse gear feel more springy. The other two shafts are first and second gears and third and fourth gears. I'm showing this stuff moving now because it gets a bit tough once the gear lever is gone. This rectangular shaped bit is the transfer box. That's the part that changes between high and low range. This is the front output housing. This is the part that changes between 2- and 4-wheel drive. Let's start with the main box. Now, apart from the oil on clutch issue, there are two known problems with this gearbox. It jumps out a third on the overrun, not every time, but on a long downhill run, it can suddenly pop out. The second problem is that the shifting on first and second sucks. It's horrible. Sorry, let me explain. I have rebuilt this gearbox before, about 2 years ago. So the problems are failures, and I'm hoping they're obvious to see when we get the box apart. That's why I'm starting this project with the gearbox. I want to know the gearbox is sorted before going any further. I do not want to be taking the gearbox in and out to troubleshoot an issue once the vehicle is freshly painted. For you non-Land Rover guys, know that the worst way to take a gearbox out is through the interior of the car. But that's how Land Rover like to do it. Here's the first look inside. You can see how the selector shafts work. This little dowel and pin arrangement is what prevents you from being able to select two gears at a time. Removing the bell housing. Once this is off, the innards start to fall out. First, the lay shaft. Now we're looking at the back of the gearbox, with the back end of the main shaft sticking through. Getting this main shaft nut off is easy. Getting it back on is a different story, but we'll get to that later. So right now, the main shaft is held in place by the rear bearing of the gearbox. The service manual says, drive it out. I can tell you, and I've done this a few times now, drive it out is understating the predicament. I suspect a few boxes have been cracked through this process. But thankfully, that hasn't happened to me yet. Thank you. This is the main shaft. This is the lay shaft. This is first gear, second gear, third gear, and fourth gear is part of the primary pinion, which is still attached to the bell housing. A key point to understand about this type of gearbox is that the four gears spin freely around the main shaft. Only the synchro or selector units actually drive the vehicle. This is the third and fourth gear synchro unit. The obvious place to start looking for the cause of slipping out of third. The selector shaft pushes the center disc one way or the other to engage third or fourth. And for some reason, it's obviously popping back into the center instead of holding itself against third gear. I replaced this unit the last time I rebuilt the box. These spring clips are known to fall out of the cheaper versions of this part. But that hasn't happened. And this is actually a good quality Italian-made OEM part with no obvious fault. I was hoping to see something clearly wrong, so I'd know what to fix. But there's nothing jumping out on this part. First gear just slides off, including its splined bronze bush. Followed by the synchro mesh ring. Followed by the first and second gear synchro mesh unit. Land Rover added synchro mesh to first and second gear only at the very end of the Series 2A production, so earlier gearboxes don't have this. The main shaft is divided into two halves by a raised section of spline. We've just pulled everything off the back half. The rest has to come off the front. And I've just found the problem with third gear. This amount of slop is no good at all. Third gear should not be rocking around like that. Something has eaten itself loose. To get at third gear, we have to have our first encounter with the dreaded snap ring. I happen to have a pair of flat-sided snap ring pliers made just for this, but it's still difficult. My technique is to pry the snap ring open and fill the gaps between the splines with split pins until the snap ring clears the edge of its recess, and then pry the ring up the spline. Now let's see. Ooh, yellow oil. That's not good. So here's what's supposed to happen. The bronze bush fits over the main shaft, and the gear spins around the bronze bush. All of the oil passages are between the gear and the bush. But what has actually happened is the bush has seized inside the gear, and then it has been spinning virtually unlubricated around the main shaft. This bush and the other half sticking out from behind second gear is a terrible piece of Land Rover design. It should be splined to the main shaft, the same as the first gear bush. Well, at least we found the problem with third gear. Now, this is the first and second gear synchro unit. This is a cheap pattern part, Brit part or Bearmark, I can't remember which. Let's have a closer look. Basically, the centerpiece slides back and forth in the outer piece, and there are three ball detents and springs that provide resistance. This is the original Land Rover part that I replaced last time I rebuilt the gearbox. You can see why I had to replace it. There are chunks missing. I still have the springs and two of the little balls, which are probably better quality, that I might be able to swap into the cheaper part. I'm taking the synchro unit apart inside a rag, because the balls fly across the room like a trident-shaped medieval weapon. Okay, so that'll be the chunky shifting then. Two of the springs are mangled. Piece of junk. You can see how poorly made the parts are compared to the original Land Rover version. I was thinking I could maybe make one good part from the two I have, but this piece is such low quality that I don't want to use any of it. So I put in my parts order. And while I wait for all the bits to turn up, I'll get the cosmetic work out of the way. I'll cover my paint process in more detail in an upcoming video, but basically after the metal parts are cleaned and stripped, I soak them in oxalic acid. And for just a few small parts like this, spray them with black zinc paint. The nuts and bolts are all degreased and just quickly scrubbed to knock off the worst of the grime. And then into the ultrasonic cleaner for a quick blast. I just use water with a touch of Super Rip, which is just an alkaline cleaner. And then they're soaked in evaporust overnight. Evaporust contains degreasers, so it's quite a good product to use if you're electroplating. Here's a batch of nuts I prepared earlier. The next stage is a soak in hydrochloric acid. It's easier to wire up the parts before going into the acid. So do that, because it's easier. Anyway, this is about half acid, half tap water. The parts are only in the acid for about 1 minute. I don't use the acid to remove rust if I can do it with a gentler method beforehand. The acid is just to etch the surface for plating. From the acid, thoroughly rinsed in water. Tap water first as a buffer, then distilled water. And then zinc plating. About halfway through, I give the parts a jiggle or a spin, just so the wire isn't shading the same spot. I plate the parts for about an hour. That's not a scientifically determined amount of time. I always get good results with zinc. Out of plating, the parts look great. Because they're going under the vehicle, I'll dip them in a passivate. This massively increases the corrosion resistance. The passivate process is a little finicky. I didn't get perfect results this time. I think because the water dip at the end was a little contaminated. You can see the patchy blue iridescent colour. Ideally, the passivate comes out looking almost clear. A week or so later, a bundle of Land Rover Joy shows up at the front door. This is the gasket set. I actually brought this from a New Zealand supplier to keep the package size down coming from the UK. And here's the infamous bronze bush. You can see this is a one-piece bush. I ordered OEM and a Bearmark package showed up. The guy from Land Rover Spares swears that Bearmark purchased the old stock, so this is OEM. I have no idea what you get if you order Bearmark for half the price. Anyway, I think make sure you get the one-piece bush. Land Rover had so much trouble with these tearing themselves apart at the shoulder that they superseded the part with a two-piece version. Basically, a pre-broken version. But the two-piece version has nothing to hold half of itself in place, and you're just asking for third gear problems, like I had, if you go with that option. And the star of the show, a brand new first and second gear synchro, OEM, made in Italy by a company called TAS. Just looking at it, you can tell it's a nicely machined part. Light years better than the cheap part I used last time. And snap rings. I'm showing these just to say, order at least two snap rings. You want a sacrificial one that'll get stretched going on and off, and a final one to use from the same batch. The bearings and oil seals I purchased locally. The bearings are standard sizes. Turns out one of the oil seals is not, so order the seals from a Land Rover parts supplier. Interestingly, The two blue Japanese branded boxes are metric bearings. I bet they're held in place with Whitworth fixings. Now, let's put it all back together. These two pins are part of the disaster that is the bronze bush. These pins are supposed to be what holds it in place. When I rebuilt the gearbox originally, these were both sheared off. And now this time, both sheared off. The smaller pin caused me a headache. I can see now on the footage that it was spinning in the hole. But in real life, I thought the drill was spinning against the hardened pin. So I ordered a couple of harder carbide drill bits. The carbide bit caught the pin within a couple of seconds. Well, that was easy. Now we need to go through the slightly tedious process of adjusting the clearances. This is the crux of the gearbox rebuild. First, we need to check the end float on second gear. The bronze bush must provide between 4 and 8 thousandths end float. This is adjusted by rubbing down the bushing. And then it's the same for third, between 4 and 8 thousandths. And then measure the end float of the bronze bush itself. And for this, we need to install the snap ring. Now, the service manual says between 1 and 20 thousandths. But I think that must be a misprint. 20 thousandths is way too much. Second and third gear would be bouncing all over the place. In any case, I want basically zero end float on this bush, which is a problem, because I have lots. This can only be reduced by installing thicker spacers. They're sold in specific widths. Luckily, a New Zealand-based Land Rover supplier had both of the spacers I needed, so this only caused a day or two delay. And you can see with the new spacers, I have 1/1000 end float, which is exactly what I was after. And a final test fit to check everything. This time, I'm not going to only rely on the little pins to hold things together. First, I Loctite the lower spacer in place. And I'm also going to Loctite the bronze bush to the main shaft. Sorry, next guy. A little heat and you'll be right. The back half of the main shaft assembly is much more straightforward. The first and second gear synchro unit just slides onto the spline. followed by the first gear bronze bush, followed by first gear, and that's it. Main shaft complete. Well, complete apart from the third and fourth gear synchro, which just slides onto the front end. Now, you may not be aware of this, but I'm also a master woodmaker. Main shaft, lay shaft, first, second, third, fourth. This is neutral. The motor is turning the primary pinion, which spins the lay shaft, which spins all of the gears at once. But neither of the synchro units are attached to a gear, so the output shaft is neutral. So now, if we push the first and second gear synchro unit into first gear is locked to the synchro unit, and the synchro unit is splined to the main shaft, so we are now driving in first gear. And the same applies for second. That's properly locked in this time. And now third. And fourth. And I'll see if I can get reverse to work. These bearings happen to be sealed, only because that's what the local guy had in stock. This cursed contraption is the bearing housing for the back of the main shaft. You saw me driving the main shaft out of the bearing earlier, but you didn't see me removing the bearing from the housing. That's because I had to do that down at the local mechanics workshop. Retaining compound must be used. It even says so in the book. The bearing is actually a pretty loose fit once it gets past the outer lip. I assume it's that way by design, but perhaps this part is a little out of size. This devil internal circlip is what I needed help with getting out. It's easier to get it back in. But coming out, you'll either need truck-sized circlip pliers, or do it the way we did. The mechanic squeezed as hard as he could with his largest old pair of pliers, forearms shaking, but he held his nerve, while I tapped the outside of the circlip with a punch through the four little gaps you can see in the retainer. You can see how tight it is going in. This is a stuff-up happening right now. Not my fault. The local guy who sells bearings and seals gave me the wrong sized seal. I don't know why he couldn't interpret the sizing from the numbers on the old seal. I could, afterwards when I looked up how to size imperial seals. Anyway, he reckoned the numbers meant nothing and that it was a common sized seal. He was wrong. I don't figure any of this out until something doesn't feel right later on in the rebuild. The outside of the bearing retainer must be covered in Loctite, otherwise oil will leak from the gearbox into the transfer case. This is Loctite 609 retaining compound, not just standard threadlock. And then another large circlip on the outside. The outside one is a little easier to get on and off. Unless you have proper large circlip pliers, use cheap ones, because the undersized tips will break off. This pair is pre-broken. Now we need to drive the main shaft back into its bearing. And then install reverse gear. The gear and spacers just ride on a shaft tapped in from the back. The lay shaft just sits in a bearing race at the back of the box. And now it's time to mate the gearbox and bell housing. It's a little awkward. This constant gear has to slide onto the lay shaft at the same time as the two halves are pulled together, because it sits behind the lip of fourth gear. So you have to hold it through a gap with your extra pair of hands. I remember this was easier to do with the gearbox vertical. I remember wrong.